thank you very much. Good evening. Everybody's festival going well? That's good, because this is not really the forum to address any complaints that you have. So listen, since its founding more than 30 years ago by Martin Scorsese, who was, by the way, right here in this theater, the first ever recipient of the Robert Osborne Award, the Film Foundation has restored better than 900 classic movies from all over the world, including the film you'll be seeing tonight, the world premiere of the 4K restoration of Giant. Steven Spielberg and Martin Scorsese handpicked this movie to be the latest Film Foundation restoration project, worked with the Warner Brothers Archives team for a year to complete it. I think most of you know that Giant is a seminal film in Hollywood history. A boldly progressive picture for the mid-1950s, Giant was ahead of its time, and it remains an incredibly relevant film 66 years after its release. Earned George Stevens his second Best Director Oscar after A Place in the Sun. And it is really my pleasure to welcome people to the stage who can speak authoritatively and passionately about this film. So please welcome first Film Foundation Executive Director Margaret Bodie. Thank you, Margaret. Also producer, director, and author, George Stevens Jr. And film director, you may have heard of him. He was here last night, actually, enjoyed E.T., I believe. Please welcome Steven Spielberg. This is a panel. I like it. I like it. So, Margaret, there we go. We've lost that. Margaret, you have a message to read from a colleague.
I have a special message from New York. Martin Scorsese, who, of course, with Steven and several other, George Lucas, Stanley Kubrick, several other directors, in 1990 created the Film Foundation to do just this, what we're here doing tonight, looking at a beautifully restored classic film that has touched so many people, and looking at it together in a beautiful movie palace. And you know, we're just so grateful to be here for TCM, who also basically do the same thing that the Film Foundation does in spirit. So Marty would have loved to be here, and he just wanted to share a little note with the audience. He said, "I saw and experienced Giant for the first time when I sneaked into its New York premiere at the Roxy Theater. I was 13 years old." But that's another story. And you have to get Marty here to tell that story, because it's pretty wild. I became obsessed with the picture and have gone back to it so many times over the years, and every time it's yielded more, keeps inspiring me and has enriched me and pushed me. I love it. At a certain point, we all realized that the film needed a lot of restoration, and as the technology has advanced over the years, there was a lot more work that became possible to do. I'm deeply grateful for Daphne Dentz and Bob Bailey of Warner Brothers and the whole team at Warner Brothers. They've given us all a great and truly precious gift with this new restoration.
Thank you, Margaret, and thank you to Marty. So, Stephen, what was your initial relationship with Giant? Did you sneak in, or did you pay like a grown-up for the film?
No. My initial relationship with Giant was the first time I saw it. I saw it on television. Not the best way to see.
That's how George Stevens envisioned it, to be seen on television with commercial breaks and cut down. That was his passion. Yeah.
Well, then his passion was realized with me, because it worked on the small screen too. But it is called Giant, and I screened it for myself many, many times. I would just get a 35 millimeter print, and I would sit there in a screening room at Universal, that where we show all the rushes, and I would just run Giant. And I ran Giant. Maybe I've seen Giant on the medium sized screen about 20 times, but I have seen Giant overall at least 50 times. I'm sure.
George, what do you think it is about this movie that speaks to people, that speaks to 13-year-old boys, that speaks to fully grown film directors?
Well, someone said, you know, that this is an epic film, was the most expensive picture that Warner Brothers had made to that time, and about twice as expensive as Jack Warner thought it was going to be. And it was the most successful box office picture of Warner's. But for an epic film, someone pointed out, it's really remembered more for the breadth of its humanity. And there's so many characters and themes that resonate, and you know, I think that's what's important about it. And also, it speaks to themes, including the situation with the Hispanic people in Texas at that time, 1950s, and a strong woman at its center, which were not common. And I think it makes it a very modern film for today.
In my fantasy world, which you were heavily involved in, Stephen,
I think you should clarify that.
Do you and Marty like call each other and be like, "What do you want to do next? Let's do Giant." Like, how does that process work?
Well, the process, you know, we have a really great process. Margaret and Marty and our board, you know, we all can put names into a hamper to basically discuss which films should be restored. There used to be a lot of urgency with restoration based on nitrate film that was easily flammable and would be, and you know, 50% of all the movies ever made have already been destroyed and cannot be found. So it was very, very important. Now, Giant didn't fall into that category, but George Stevens did a very amazing thing with Giant. The entire first third of the film has these long, slow bleed-overs or dissolves from one scene to the next. And they used to do dissolves called optical dissolves. And so years ago, when Giant was first made in 1956, all they had was an optical printer. And when you put anything through an optical printer, the film loses a generation, which means where you see a dissolve, it's grainy. And then when the dissolve is over, it's clear again. And even when they struck the first Blu-ray I saw of Giant, there still was a big issue with all those dissolves. They were still, I thought, a little unacceptably grainy. So this restoration was, the 4K restoration was really to try to correct that and to try to make it blend with the rest of the film, which Warner Brothers, they did, Bob, and they did a great job. And so I called George about a year ago, and I just said, I really like the Blu-ray, I think it's great, but would you mind if we took another pass at it? And George immediately said, do it.
And, you know, there are all kinds of people in the movie world, but Stephen, there's no person busier in Hollywood and has more opportunities to be making more films and raising a family. What really defines certain people, and Marty can be counted in this, is that Stephen has time outside of all of his own endeavors to take it upon himself to say, this film means a lot to film history and I want to do something about it. And I salute you, Stephen, for that quality in you. I was here in 1956 in this theater when we all came in, and Rock and Elizabeth and my father had their footprints and handprints put in the cement out there just before the premiere. But I want to talk about another occasion with my father that I think speaks to this evening. It involves another film. It was the 1951 Academy Awards. My father had come back from 3 years at war, and he made a film of Theodore Dreiser's An American Tragedy called A Place in the Sun, Montgomery Clift, Elizabeth Taylor. And I went to the Academy Awards with my father and my mother and his mother, the actress Georgie Cooper. And I remember Dad was driving the car. And I sat next to him. It was here, the Academy Awards in the Chinese theater. And somewhere on there in an aisle, and Joseph Mankiewicz, name familiar, came on the stage. He was then president of the Directors Guild to announce the award for Best Director. And he said the nominees are John Huston, Asphalt Jungle, an African Queen, Vincent Minnelli, An American in Paris, William Wyler, The Desperate Hours, Elia Kazan, A Streetcar Named Desire, and George Stevens, A Place in the Sun. Well, I don't know if the fix was in, but Joe pulled Dad's name out. And but the story is driving home that night. He was driving the car. The Oscar was in the seat between us. And I was, about, I think, 19 or something, and pretty excited, I guess. And anyway, he looked over. Maybe he thought I was too excited. But he looked at me, and he said, you know, he said, we'll have a better idea what kind of a film this is in about 25 years. You know, he was speaking to what the Film Foundation is concerned with, the test of time. And that, and so how touched he would be to see that this wonderful crowd is here tonight 65 years, not 25 years, after its making. And, you know, that he had made a film that stood the test of time.
What I took from that story is that it was a pretty easy win that year. Man, that is some competition. Margaret, let me just, what is it, has the process over the last 32 years, Film Foundation founded in 1990, I take it the process of restoring films, in just in general, is it much easier? Is it harder? Is it...
Well, the process has changed because the technology changes. And Giant's a really good example of, you know, a film that has actually been preserved and restored a few times. Because when restoration, you know, began in the, you know, I mean, the archives were doing it from the 50s, 60s, 70s. And the studios, you know, started doing it a little bit more once the awareness was raised, thanks to Stephen and Marty and directors who really advocated for it. It was all photochemical. So that was the gold standard, is you would, you know, make a film-to-film copy. And so preservation was how we really brought films back to life and made them available for future generations for about, I think, you know, at least 15 years from the first part of, you know, the first half of the Film Foundation. And when, with the advent of digital technology, there were just these incredible new tools that would allow you to take, for example, like a three-strip Technicolor film and finally make those color records in accurate registration, so you wouldn't have fringing around characters, and you could, you know, repair scratches and tears that were, you know, they take you out of the film. So, you know, if used with a light touch, digital technology is, you know, an enormous kind of a revolutionary change for film restoration. You can restore films that you wouldn't see otherwise. So Giant was first photochemically preserved in 95 or 96?
Well, no, I think in the 70s first. And
right.
I think I've been involved in four restorations. This is the fourth.
I think when we first, you know, started the preservation kind of movement, you know, the idea was let's just restore and preserve everything, right? And then the realization is as the new technology changes and people are, the image quality is so much better on home entertainment, you just keep improving that so that new audiences and new generations will discover these films and the films are kind of kept up to the current standards.
George, I was in reading your wonderful book, My Place in the Sun, Life in the Golden Age of Hollywood and Washington. George, by the way, book signing tomorrow at the lobby of the Hollywood Roosevelt at 11 a.m. So, and the book is wonderful, but only if you care about movies. So you have the, you know, memo sent from Jack Warner to your father. where he thinks the screenplay is a little long, and he's worried that this, he says in the memo, like, hey, is there any way, you know, maybe if you, you know, it's great, it's wonderful, but maybe you get it down from it. Let's say it might be 2 hours and 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. Do you think maybe you could get it down to 2 hours?
Right.
And your dad has a very pleasant reply. They're so nice to each other in the memos, right? Yeah. We ended up with a movie, what, at 1.8 million, ends up 5.4 million, and the screenplay's how long, 300 and how many pages?
I worked with my father and the writers on the screenplay. I got out of the Air Force from Occidental College. I mean, I got a commission to go in the Air Force, and the Korean War ended, so I didn't have anything to do. And my father was just starting Giant, and he said, well, come work with us. So I sat for 7 months with the writers every morning. But we found a typist from Warner Brothers, and we kept widening the margins so there'd be fewer pages.
Your father had this wonderful reputation of, you know, that I think, you know, I'm sure irritated the Jack Warners of the world, but he had a vision, and he had Final Cut, and believed in all that that meant, right? So he didn't seem ever swayed, and he ended up with this, again, epic, but masterpiece.
Wonderful, thank you, yeah.
Was there a tension? Was there a moment where, is it your sense that your father ever thought, you know what, I gotta take 30 minutes out of this movie or Jack Warner's gonna bite my head off?
No, he had a great deal of confidence in this. They worked very hard on the screenplay. It was the only screenplay that he said he really shot, you know, with very few changes. Almost all his other pictures, they were working on the script during production. And he had confidence in it. And it was, he believed in it.
I know that you came back from, you were in the Air Force, you'd been in Florida, you flew back to Los Angeles, you went to dinner at Musso and Frank with your mom and dad, right? And then you go across the street to the Egyptian. What do you see?
We went to the Egyptian, had dinner at Musso Frank's, went across to the Egyptian, and Dad wanted us to see East of Eden, because there was a kind of scruffy kid that hung around his office at Warner Brothers, and he had a secretary assistant named Leona Heath, and she took such a distaste to this kid in dirty jeans. But we went, and I saw come onto the screen this fellow and move so cat-like across the screen, and it was James Dean, who was the scruffy kid. And, you know, he talked to Richard Burton, Robert Mitchum, and it was really a change in casting, to cast a much slighter figure.
Because Jet, in your father's imagination, this was a big,
yeah,
tough, burly Texan,
yeah,
right? But
yeah,
not after seeing James Dean.
Yeah.
What's that, Stephen, you must have had that experience where you have an idea for an actor in your head, right? Even if you're trying to be open, and then someone comes in and changes the idea completely.
No, usually for me, I have an idea for an actor in my brain, and they all say no.
Sure, yeah. Sure, so, you get turned down all the time.
Well,
now. Yeah.
When I made Jaws, the first person I wanted to play Quint was Lee Marvin.
Oh.
He said no. Then I went to Sterling Hayden, and he said no. And so finally, David Brown just said, what about Robert Cho? I just work with him in The Sting, and that's how that happened. But it happens often.
Right, yeah. So the book is such wonderful detail about so many things, George. The rest of the casting, I mean, the normal process, the Audrey Hepburn, right, was the first thought.
Yeah, Audrey, I think Audrey turned it down.
Yeah.
Because Grace Kelly was considered, but MGM wouldn't have. And there were also Bill Holden and older actors. And Dad had an idea about how films worked. And he thought that an audience was more ready to accept or believe a romance among younger people. And so he cast Elizabeth, who was 23, Rock, who was 28, knowing that they were going to have to go play people in their 60s at the end of the film, and Jimmy Dean, who was 23. So it was a very young cast, and a good one.
Yeah, it was a good one. It worked out. He seems to have made the right calls. I do a lead-in, and people are always, they always react the way this audience did, and we all do as movie lovers when you think, you hear these other names associated with these iconic roles, right? You think, oh my God, what if Audrey Hepburn instead of Elizabeth Taylor, right? Robert Mitchum instead of James Dean. But when the movie works, right, then it becomes impossible to imagine anybody else. Yeah.
You watch a movie and you see Elizabeth Taylor in this, and you know she's young, and you know later on in the film that they sort of spray her hair a little gray, and as well as rock, but you suspend your disbelief because you fall passionately in love with this marriage. And this you know, it's interesting. If Bergman hadn't used the title, they could have called George's film Giant Scenes from a Marriage, because these are scenes from a marriage.
They are.
Of two very, you know, strong-willed and stubborn people who are going to, you know, try to, you know, live life in their way. And it's great to see them often, you know, knock heads.
Yeah, that's right. And it and stick with it despite those enormous differences and that very different outlook, and despite all that stubbornness. So, George, as you mentioned, you were on set in the beginning, or in the process in the beginning in production, working for 7 months with the writing, and then back at the end, because the film took so wonderfully long to make. How many days eventually of production, just by the way?
I forget what it added up to, but it was about 80 more than Jack Warner wanted.
Right, sure. And then to say nothing of the editing afterwards and compiling everything together. So, but you were there in that process too, right?
You know, I just remembered here, I was, you know, obviously young. I was just out of the Air Force, 22, I guess, and three. And thank God, we editing this film, 3-hour, 20-minute film. It was longer than that, you know, and trimming it down. And Dad just kept, started reel one and go through it, and he'd change a close-up, and he'd take something off of this scene. And I remember a hot day at Warner Brothers, and I said, Dad, God, this picture's awfully good. Don't you just think you ought to get it off there, you know? And he said, think about how many man hours, as the term was in those days, are going to be spent watching this film. Don't you think it's a good idea for us to spend a little more of our time improving it?
Wow.
You know, man. I mean, and here we are, people spending their hours.
George, I'd like to get a couple of stories out of you, just because you were there, and so you did get to know James Dean, who was basically your age, right?
Yeah.
There's a lunch with you on the lot with you and James Dean and Dennis, right? Dennis Stock, right?
They
took all those great pictures.
Yeah.
So what was that? And then I love the little, you get a slice of what was going through Dean's head, even though he tried to seem like he didn't care.
Yeah, but it's a big, the executive dining room or whatever they call it, and they had the big pictures framed of Bogey and Cagney and all of them, and Jimmy had this kind of mercurial way, and when he got up to go out, he kind of winked at Dennis Stock, and he went and he kind of stood between the pictures and made himself real thin. He had a very much a sense of presenting himself.
But in between Cagney and Bogey, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And then you were friendly with him, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you were friendly with him.
I was.
Yeah.
I guess I just would mention, I was, again, in the Air Force, I was at the studio during the filming of the fight scene in the cafe that I don't want to give the movie away, but there's a fight scene. I was sitting there, and remember Jimmy came in, and he had his kind of tinted glasses, and came and sat down next to me, and he said, and Dad, he'd agreed with my father that Dad had asked. He said he had this appetite for racing cars, and he said, I'm going to have to ask you not to race cars while we're making this picture, because if you get hurt, it's going to put 400 people out of, and Jimmy said he would, and he held to that. And then he told me he'd finished shooting before the others, and he said, I just bought a Porsche Spyder 500. And He said, want to ride? So we walked out of the soundstage, and here's this little silver roadster. And you climb in, and it's called the Little Bastard, he named it. And he revs it up, and we go careening through the tall sound stages with the sound echoing. And
on the lot.
On the lot, you know. And we're back in, fortunately, the prop truck or the police, you know. But he was, that was his nature. And anyway, so we, he kind of parked the car, and he grinned, you know, and I grinned back. And we went back. But it was, sadly, 3 weeks later, that he was going to race the car in Salinas, and he told my father that he was going to truck it up. That then in the morning of, he decided to drive it up. And that decision, you know, led to this great misfortune, you know, because he was a talent, and I think he would have become a director. And it was a light went out when Jimmy died.
You think he would have been a director? Is that...
Yeah. I mean, yeah, actors started doing that.
What do you, Stephen, does that make sense? Actors become, I mean, other directors have told me that that actors make the best directors.
They make, yeah. They make good directors, they don't make the best directors.
Good, good, Stephen.
I could talk.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah, sure,
George?
Yeah, please.
Were you on the set, or I've always wanted to know how Jimmy did that thing with the lariat when they were trying to buy Little Riotto.
Yeah.
What was that? Did he come up with that? Did the writers come up with that, or did your dad come up with that?
Jimmy was, there was a fellow named Bob Hinkle who was our Texas talk man. And Jimmy spent a lot of time with him, and he taught him to play with the lariat. And you know, it's Jimmy's idea to use that. And that little salute that he uses when he walks out of the room.
That was Jimmy's?
My father was known for shooting a lot of film and covering every angle, which enabled him to work around and shorten scenes and be off of actors when their performance wasn't good. It was really a tool for him. But there's a scene where Jimmy Dean... I don't want to tell too much about the movie, but when he's offered some land, and you just notice that the camera stays on him for 3 minutes.
Right. You didn't need the coverage there.
Yeah.
Well, I have so many more things to ask, and I could talk to you guys forever, but it is a 3-hour and 20-minute movie. And by the way, I'm always struck by this, and this reaction is going to be more than you think. How many people here at the TCM Classic Film Festival, these are all classic movie fans, how many people have not seen Giant? I'm not going to be able to... Oh, look at that. A lot.
Good.
Yeah, it's really stunning how many people have it. Well, you're in for a treat, and you were going to see an unbelievably pristine, wonderful... Yes, go ahead.
And it does not feel like 3 hours
no,
and 20
it doesn't
minutes
feel
at all.
Like 3 hours and 20 minutes.
Thank you. Yes.
Steven Spielberg, George Stevens Jr., Margaret Bodie. Don't forget, tomorrow, 11 a.m., in the lobby of the Roosevelt, My Place in the Sun, George Stevens Jr.'s book. Thank you, guys. Enjoy the film. Thanks for coming. Thank you to all of you.